or have metastatic or HER2-positive disease. And so you hear about this HER2-positive thing all the time. And it's, you know, it's getting back to basics. What is HER2? Why do we care about it so much? So HER2 is a cell surface signaling protein. This is an artist's rendition of a cell on the left here, and similarly on the right of HER2. And if you look at normal cells in the body, normal breast cells, and even other normal cells in the body, They do have HER2 on them, but they have fewer than 10,000 copies per cell, which sounds like a lot. But when we look at a HER2 gene amplification, or cell with HER2 gene that is HER2 gene amplified with overexpression of HER2 proteins, this is, it's just an artist's rendition, but it gives us a sense of that these cells have as many as 2 million or upwards of that HER2 proteins on a cancer cell. So they have many of these molecules on the cell surface. And so again, so a little bit of back to basics, thinking about how do we apply and look at clinical trial data in patients who are undergoing therapies and compare which therapies are effective. So you may be familiar with Kaplan-Meier curves, but in case you're not, this is a Kaplan-Meier plot that allows us to compare groups of patients on clinical trials and to look at their outcomes to see which group is experiencing the best benefit from the trial, the therapy that they're on. And so on the y-axis is the percentage of women without progression of disease, and on the x-axis is time. And so if you had a therapy that you were testing and the new therapy that you wanted to see if it was effective, more effective than the older therapy, you would expect to see a big separation of those two curves. So here the red would be hopefully the new therapy that you're testing, and the blue would be the older therapy. So that'll be helpful here in a second. So back to HER2. If we think about HER2 amplification, we know about it now, but where did that idea come from? So scientists working in the lab back in the 1980s saw that there was this amplification of HER2 on breast cancer cells and wanted to know, what does that mean? So they compared groups of patients, they looked at the piece of the tumor under the microscope and looked at patients who had HER2 overexpression versus those who didn't. And they saw this big difference in how patients did over time. And they saw that patients, and these were patients who had earlier stage disease, so breast cancer that had undergone chemotherapy and surgery and radiation, those kinds of things. And at that time, we also thought of breast cancer as one big disease, not separate smaller diseases. So they saw that the patients who didn't have amplified HER2 on their cells were the patients in the, let's see if I have a pointer here. No. So in the top curve there, the not amplified group, and then in the bottom curve there was the patients with the HER2 amplification. So thought that based on this information, this was something that we really needed to address in patients with breast cancer and these patients with this HER2 amplification. So after a lot of work in the lab, a lot of work in clinical trials with patients, trastuzumab was the result of that research from the lab into the clinic. Trastuzumab is a monoclonal antibody that was developed specifically to bind to the HER2 protein. This is, again, a picture of that of Herceptin and the antibody and where it binds to the HER2 protein. So when they gave Herceptin together with chemotherapy in patients to patients who had metastatic HER2-positive breast cancer, it looked at chemotherapy plus trastuzumab versus chemotherapy alone and saw that patients here in the group who got the trastuzumab did much better than patients who received chemotherapy alone. This is really revolutionary. This is just the results from the original study that was presented, and there have been many tests of this over time showing that this is a very effective and important drug. So how do we treat metastatic HER2 breast cancer now? We know now that the HER2 amplification in the cells of patients with HER2-positive disease is really, really important. So we don't just target it one time. We continue to target it when somebody has HER2-positive metastatic disease again and again, so that's always a part of the therapy, unless there's some other reason, such as side effects from those drugs, that make it not that we can't give those drugs. So there are many, since the development of trastuzumab, there have been the development of many other drugs also directed at HER2 and to increase the efficacy of the trastuzumab. And so pertuzumab is another antibody drug that targets another aspect of HER2 and prevents the combination of the HER2 with another important target. And when we add trastuzumab to pertuzumab and chemotherapy, this is results from a study that was published in 2015 showing that when you look at how long people are living with HER2-positive metastatic disease, that the pertuzumab significantly improved how patients did. So this has become really the standard of care for first-line treatment for patients with this kind of breast cancer. TDM1 was another way of thinking about how we treat HER2-positive breast cancer, and the idea that you could use this antibody, which could very easily come and find the HER2-positive breast cancer cells, and bring a chemotherapy that otherwise would have been too toxic to give as systemic treatment to the cell itself. So this basically, some people refer to this as a smart bomb drug or something that, let me get to the animation. This is courtesy of Ian. But the TDM1 delivers, as I said, that DM1 molecule that would otherwise be too toxic to give systemically to the HER2-positive breast cancer cells. And when it binds the HER2 protein, that combination of the chemo, the antibody, and the protein go into the cell. And now the cell has basically brought in that chemotherapy right into the cell. And while it's in the cell, then those chemotherapy molecules are released into the cell and can kill those breast cancer cells specifically, rather than giving it to all the cells in the body. And then we saw from Teresa a study of TDM1 versus the treatment that of physician's choice, that it also improved how well patients did and how long they lived with metastatic HER2-positive disease. So this is another really important development in the treatment of HER2-positive metastatic breast cancer. So other things that are important that we think about in treating HER2-positive disease is we know that brain metastases are fairly common. We know that radiation is very effective at treating brain metastases, but eventually patients can develop new brain lesions, or those lesions that were treated can grow again. And so it's important that we think of other ways to effectively treat those areas. Our drugs are not, unfortunately, as effective when we give them in the body. They're not as effective at treating brain metastases as they are at treating the cancer that's in the rest of the body. And some reasons for that may be that the blood-brain barrier blocks the way of the drug for getting to the brain, but we don't know why else it might be true. So we are working on investigating that and trying to make those treatments better, but it's a really important area of need right now. So questions from, we have these effective therapies, but they're certainly not perfect and we need to do better. So some of the questions we have that we're trying to ask and trying to figure out in order to make our treatments better is, why do most tumors eventually develop resistance to a particular treatment? Why is that? How do we develop better treatments for metastatic HER2-positive breast cancer? And those two questions are probably related, but we need to understand the first one and to get to the second one. And then how can we better treat brain metastases? The tools we have right now are okay, but they're fairly limited and we need to do better. So these are a few, I just want to touch on a few of the ways that we're working on this together with you here at Dana-Farber to help address these questions and improve our therapies. This is about, so PROFILE, which may be a study that many of you have participated in, is a precision cancer medicine project where we have more than 30,000 patients have consented since 2011 when this started, and we've done more than 12,000 tests, and that's across the whole institute, using next-generation sequencing of patients' tumors to understand their genomic alterations in the tumor to help us better direct our therapies. And for breast cancer, this has been a little somewhat less promising than it has in diseases such as lung cancer and others, but it still has shown that there are potential targets that we can address through finding alterations in the tumor. Nick Wagle and Nancy Lin have led this Center for Cancer Precision Medicine study of metastatic breast cancer. And this is a slide showing sort of what happens. So patients who have metastatic breast cancer can sign up for this study. They will undergo a biopsy and also agree to have clinical information collected. From the biopsy, we do regular pathology on the tumor. So that's the same kind of pathology that a pathologist would do on if you had a regular clinical biopsy. That gives us back the ER, PR, and HER2 status of the tumor, as well as other features, which is really important because tumors can evolve over time. We do target sequencing, which is the same thing that happens through profile, which I just spoke about. There are whole exome sequencing and transcriptome sequencing, other kinds of sequencing, and those are really research projects to understand these mechanisms of resistance to treatment that we are trying to figure out. We do blood, or we call liquid biopsies, which I'll talk more about later today in a breakout session. And we do cell line models and mouse models. Again, these are all ways of understanding ways of resistance so that we can make better treatments. And then some additional molecular studies and banking. So this is a great way when somebody needs a biopsy otherwise to also participate in research and so that we can, again, help to understand why breast cancers develop resistance and how we can better treat them. Circulating tumor DNA is another area of interest, a personal area of interest of mine, that where we take a blood biopsy rather than a tissue biopsy. Obviously, blood biopsy is much easier to easier on patients. Metastatic biopsies are challenging and can certainly be painful. We know that cancer cells and normal cells shed their DNA into the blood, and we can take that blood and isolate the DNA and then identify alterations in the genes to better understand ways in which the cancer might be becoming resistant. We are doing this right now in the EMBRACE study that Nancy Lin runs, where patients sign up to donate their clinical information as well as blood when they're here to better understand mechanisms of resistance and disease. So how can we do better overall, and how can you all help us all do better? Participating in clinical trials is really the best way for patients to actively participate in finding better treatments for breast cancer. Clinical trials are available for patients at any step of their breast cancer journey. And trials are really we think of them as part of the continuum of care. So every time a patient that I am meeting with has a reason for treatment change or another sort of step along the way where we're trying to figure out what to do next, I think about standard of care options and also clinical trials. There are definitely benefits to being on a trial. You have a really large, if any of you have experienced this, you have a large, excellent treatment team who's there for you. You may have exposure to cutting-edge new medications. That's really the idea. You're helping other patients with breast cancer and trying to understand these questions that we're trying to answer. And really, it's important to just think about that none of the advances in breast cancer that we have and that all patients are benefiting from could have ever happened without patients volunteering to be in clinical trials. So with that, Ian is going to take over and talk a little bit about novel drugs to overcome resistance to HER2 therapies.
Thank you, Heather, for that perfect segue. And just to remind you, this is supposed to be interactive, so I'm going to talk for 10 minutes, I think, and then we'll open things up to questions. If you have a question, just to keep things simple, if you wouldn't mind just writing it down, and we have people in the back who will come pick them up. Just raise your hand and they'll come pick them up, and then we'll go over them at the end. It may end up we break down and actually just do regular questions, but we'll try to start out at least with cards. Okay, so we talked about that HER2-positive disease, there's a lot of new treatments, and many of them work really well, but eventually cancers seem to become resistant to most of our treatments, and we need to figure out new treatments to deal with this thing called resistance that Heather mentioned. And you know, the way we figure these new drugs out is a lot of people in the lab are figuring out new molecules and new ways to overcome resistance, but then the only way we can actually test these is for people to participate in clinical trials. So I wanted to just mention a few of the kinds of clinical trials that we're working on now. There are more that we just don't have time to go over everything, but this is just hopefully some good examples of what we're doing right now. So the first thing I want to talk about is what's called an antibody-drug conjugate, and you've already heard about the first one of these, which is TDM1. And again, the idea here is that you're using this antibody, which is this very specific protein that can go through the bloodstream and just stick to your cancer cell, as a way to deliver a chemotherapy drug selectively to your cancer cell. So TDM1 was actually the first of these drugs to ever be approved for people who have solid cancers. There's other of these drugs for things like leukemia, but this was the first one, and it worked well. Not only is it effective at killing the cancer cells, but the side effects are pretty minimal because of this very specific way of delivering the drug right to the cancer cells. But this was, you know, we call this proof of concept. It was an idea. They made a molecule, they tested it in clinical trials, and it did what we wanted it to do. So that kind of opened the door to other kind of follow-up molecules to see if we could do even better with this same idea. And so the one that's in the clinical trials right now, or one of them, is called DS8201A. You can tell a drug is fairly early because it just has a number. In fact, actually, just very recently, it was given a generic name, which is even more of a mouthful than just trastuzumab. So this is called trastuzumab deruxtecan. But what it is, again, same idea of TDM1. So you have this antibody with a chemotherapy attached to it. And the reason this is different than TDM1 is that it's got an even more potent, even more strong chemotherapy attached to it, and it works in a different way than the DM1 does in TDM1. And there's actually more of them. So with TDM1, there's 3 or 4 of these chemotherapies attached to each antibody, and with this, there's 8. So why is that important? Well, so you can imagine if your idea is to deliver this chemotherapy right to the cancer cell, if every time an antibody sticks to a cancer cell, it delivers twice as much chemotherapy to that cell, then maybe it's going to work even better. That's the idea. So it's loaded with more of these chemotherapy drugs. And this one has what's called bystander effect, meaning that when it goes into a cell, that some of the chemotherapy actually gets released into the surrounding area. So if you have a neighboring cell that for some reason the drug can't get to, the antibody can't get to, the chemotherapy can leak out and kill the neighboring cell too. So for all of those reasons, it was thought that this might be an even more potent drug than TDM1. And it turns out that seems to be the case. So we've just finished the phase 1, the first trial of this drug. The results are pretty impressive. You've heard of a Kaplan-Meier curve that Heather presented. Another way we look at clinical trial data is what's called a waterfall plot. And the reason they're called waterfall plots is because normally there's like it's a mixture of results. And the way this is, what this is basically each of these little bars is a patient on the trial, and that black line in the middle is no change in their tumor, and so anything below this line means the cancer shrank, and anything above it means the cancer grew. And so normally it's called a waterfall plot because there's like half the people have the tumor grow and half the people have the tumor shrink. This one looks a little funny because virtually everybody's cancer shrank. So, you know, basically everybody, but except for these 4 or 5 people, all these cancers shrank when they're given this drug. Overall, about 65% of the cancers had really substantial shrinkage, but virtually everybody had some shrinkage of their cancer. So this looks like a really promising drug, and it's already into phase 3 trials, which I'll show you in a minute. We have that trial, and actually the drug may even get accelerated approval by the FDA sometime in the coming year. But there's a trade-off, as with most things. So by giving a stronger chemotherapy, you also get a little bit more side effects. So this one is not quite as pure direction, you know, pure targeted as T-DM1. So people do get some nausea and vomiting, which you don't usually get with T-DM1. And about 30% or so of people lose their hair, which doesn't happen with T-DM1. And some people seem to get some inflammation of their lungs, which is treatable, but it can be a problem. So there's a trade-off here, but it's certainly nice to have, or it certainly will be nice to have a drug that has a very high effectiveness rate, and we're going to have to learn how to manage the side effects better. But this one looks promising. This is the trial that's going on that'll open here in the next few weeks, which is comparing this new drug versus treatment of physician's choice. So this will be something that'll be available for patients in the next few weeks. And again, the drug itself hopefully will be approved even before this trial is done, maybe sometime next year. And this is just a, you're not supposed to read the details here, but this is just a list of all of these new antibody drug conjugates that are coming in development right now. So a lot of work is being done. Again, because T-DM1 showed the way that this approach works, there's now a number of other drugs with variations on the theme being tested. So we're really excited about this class of drug. Okay. Now, another type of drug that many of you may already be familiar with is what's called a signaling inhibitor. So going back to the kinds of diagrams that Heather showed, you know, we talked about HER2 sitting on the surface of the cells, and that there's way too many of them in these HER2-positive cancers. Well, so what does HER2 do to make them have people's cancer become more aggressive, as you saw when you have a HER2-positive cancer? Why are they more aggressive? Well, it's because each of these HER2 proteins sends a signal into the cell to tell it to be more aggressive. That's its normal function. And of course, if you have several million of these proteins sitting on the surface of the cell, all telling the cell to be more aggressive, it gets more aggressive. So knowing that, in addition to drugs like Herceptin and T-DM1, which bind to the outside of HER2, we also have drugs that go inside the cell and block that signaling. And so the first one of these is called lapatinib or ticarb, and that was approved a decent number of years ago. And it works okay. You use it with chemotherapy. The one we usually use it with is called capecitabine. And it definitely can shrink some cancers and stop cancers from growing. The problem with it is it doesn't always work, and it's not quite as specific as we would like. So it blocks HER2, but it blocks some related proteins, one of which is called HER1, which is also known as EGFR. And the problem is blocking EGFR causes diarrhea, causes rash, and so it can be an annoying drug to be on because of those problems. And what we really wanted to do is block HER2, because that's the problem child there. So tucatinib is the next generation of these drugs, and it's also a good inhibitor of HER2, but it does not block HER1 and HER4. So it's much more selective. And again, you know, you heard about targeted therapy, so this is the idea. Let's block the problem in the cancer cell and not HER proteins that are used in normal cells. So because it's more selective, you don't have the diarrhea and rash nearly to the same extent as you do with lapatinib. And so far, this one looks pretty promising. And we have a trial right now called HER2 Climb that some of you may have heard about or that could be potentially on in the future, which is basically adding tucatinib to a standard combination of Herceptin and chemotherapy. The other neat thing about this drug is because it's not a big molecule like Herceptin, it's a little tiny chemical molecule that can go inside cells. It also gets into the brain really well. And there's been some studies that show that this actually can be effective in people who have HER2-positive brain metastases. And in fact, unlike virtually any other clinical trial, if you have brain metastases, even that hasn't been treated yet or has progressed after treatment, you can still go on this trial because they think it's actually going to help patients who have progressive brain metastases as well. So it's kind of a unique aspect of this trial. Nancy Lin, who's our brain met specialist here, also has several other clinical trials looking at tucatinib in this setting. So again, very promising approach, trying to be more selective so you cut down on side effects, and it seems to be doing that. So the other side of the coin is neratinib, just as a little trivia point. So drugs that end in IB are small molecule chemicals. Drugs that end in AB, like trastuzumab, are big proteins. So if you ever want to figure out the difference, that's it. So neratinib is another small molecule. It gets inside cells. It blocks HER2. And it actually is probably the most potent inhibitor of HER2 that we know about. In fact, it actually chemically links itself to HER2. So once it gets into the cell and binds to a HER2, it's never coming off. So it's a very potent inhibitor. But like lapatinib, it also blocks these other related proteins like EGFR. And again, because it's so strong, it does a really good job at blocking these other proteins. So you get more side effects with this than any of the other small molecules. So you get a lot of diarrhea with this. So it looks like a very active drug. It definitely works. But it has this downside of having more diarrhea. So we are now working very hard at coming up with very proactive, aggressive ways of treating diarrhea. And when you do that, it seems to be much more manageable. We think, you know, now this is a drug that's certainly something that is worth considering now that we know how to manage it. And Heather is actually running a trial right now for patients with estrogen receptor positive HER2 positive cancer. So, you know, about half of the HER2 positive cancers also have estrogen receptors. And so this is a trial that if you have that kind of HER2 positive cancer, you can go on. And it's a randomization, but everybody gets the neratinib. So everybody gets a drug that we know can be effective. And half the patients also get another hormone therapy called fulvestrant. Because there's some reasons to think from the laboratory that blocking both estrogen receptor and HER2 can be better than just blocking one or the other. So Heather's testing that in this trial. So we think this is a good trial because everybody gets at least one active drug, and half the people get two potentially active drugs. Okay. Lastly, I just want to touch on immunotherapy. This is the buzzword that a lot of you have heard about in the news. If you watch the Red Sox or any other sporting event, you'll see advertisements for Keytruda and other immunotherapy. So what is immunotherapy? It's long been known that the immune system is supposed to kill cancer cells. You know, we think of the immune system as killing bacteria and viruses and the flu, but it's also supposed to kill cancer cells, and it actually usually does that. The problem is sometimes it doesn't. And, you know, when someone has a cancer that's growing, it's a sign that the immune system didn't quite do its job. And we've known that for many years, and scientists have been trying to figure out ways to stimulate the immune system to kill cancer cells in that situation, and really we're not really able to do that for many years. It's kind of been the holy grail of cancer oncology is to try to figure out ways to stimulate the immune system to do this. So everything changed about four or five years ago when we finally figured out why, at least in some cases, why cancers were not being killed by a person's immune system. And that is because the immune system has an on-off switch. When you have a bacterial infection or some other kind of infection, you want the immune system to rise up and kill that bacteria. But when the bacteria is gone, you don't want the immune system to keep cranking along and giving you fevers and chills and muscle aches for the rest of your life. You want the immune system to turn back off. And so, of course, the immune system has such an off switch. It doesn't quite look like this, because this would be easy. So the way it looks, and I apologize for the very crappy animation that you're about to see, but that's just, we all have our limitations. The immune system cell that we mostly care about to fight the cancer cells is called the T cell. And the T cells recognize tumor cells via this thing called the T cell receptor, and they bind to things on the cancer cell that make them look different. The immune system is surveying the body, looking for things that aren't supposed to be there, and those are called antigens, and they recognize that on the tumor cell. It revs up the T cell then kills the tumor cell. Okay, that's the way it's supposed to work. But again, as I said, T cells have an off switch, and in this case, it's called one of them is called PD-1. And again, when the T cell is activated and the tumor cell is killed, the T cell starts making this protein called PD-1, and that's how it's supposed to be turned off once the tumor is gone. Tumor cells, unfortunately, are pretty smart, and they recognize that the T cells have this off switch on them, and so they figured out that if they make a protein called PD-L1, it can bind to PD-1 and turn off the T cell, the tumor cell is now not killed, and it's able to grow. So this doesn't happen all the time. This isn't the answer in every patient and in every tumor, but in a lot of time, at least a lot of cancers, this seems to be what's going on, is the tumor cell makes this thing called PD-L1, turns off the T cells, the immune system is now suppressed, and the tumor can grow. Okay, but now we've figured this out. What do we do? So we have these things called antibodies that you've now heard a lot about. These are the drugs that end in MAB. And we developed antibodies that block either PD-1 or PD-L1. It doesn't matter. You just want to keep these two proteins from touching each other. And now the tumor cell cannot turn off the T cell because its PD-L1 is blocked by these antibodies. The T cell can now turn back on, kill the tumor cell, and the cancer is suppressed. And it turns out this is exactly what happens. And in cancers that have high levels of PD-L1, like melanoma and lung cancer, these drugs, what they're called checkpoint inhibitors or PD-1, PD-L1 inhibitors, have revolutionized the care of these cancers. So these used to be horrible cancers that nothing worked in, and now these drugs have really made a dramatic impact on this cancer. So, of course, when we see all that excitement going on in melanoma and lung cancer, we want to see if it also works in breast cancer. And we've been a little bit behind for a number of good and potentially not so good reasons, but we're now starting to develop these drugs in breast cancer. This week, there will be the results of a clinical trial, I think even today, being presented in Munich, Germany, where there's a big cancer conference right now. The first positive trial of an immune therapy in breast cancer. This is a trial in patients with triple negative breast cancer, showing that these immune therapies actually help people live longer when added to chemotherapy. So that's the first really strongly positive trial we've had in breast cancer of immune therapy. It's going to lead to the approval of one of these drugs in patients with triple negative breast cancer. So that's great news. What about HER2-positive breast cancer? So we have a smaller amount of data so far. We have a phase small trial that looked at Herceptin plus one of these PD-1 inhibitors, and it worked in some patients, about 15% of people. We felt that was a little disappointing. Obviously, we want to do better than 15%. So we are now working on how to do better than that. And to talk about that, we need to mention one more thing, and that's called ADCC. So in most breast cancers, we depend upon these T cells to kill the cancer cells. In HER2-positive cancer, we have another trick up our sleeves, and that's this thing called ADCC. And so what ADCC is, it's antibody-dependent cell toxicity. So basically using antibodies to help kill cells. Because it turns out that there's another kind of cell in the body called a natural killer cell. Sounds like a good way to kill cancer cells. So these NK cells, which are the guys over here in orange, recognize tumor cells that have antibodies attached to them. And so here, in our case, we have a HER2-positive cancer, and so all these little points here are HER2, and the antibody we talk about is Herceptin or trastuzumab. And so these NK cells can recognize the Herceptin on the cancer cells, and they get activated and kill the cancer cells. And these cells, a different kind of approach, but the same idea, it's another way of killing cancer cells. And we already activate this when we use Herceptin, so the idea was, how can we make that work better? Now I need to tell you about one more molecule, and that's called 4-1BB, and that is a way to activate these NK cells. And it turns out if you activate 4-1BB on an NK cell, it helps kill the cell better, and even better, if you mix Herceptin with 4-1BB activators, the two of them work well together, and 4-1BB, just as an icing on the cake, also helps T cells activate, and T cells are the ones we talked about a minute ago that are activated by these checkpoint inhibitors like PD-1. So it turns out that you can, in the laboratory, mix a 4-1BB activator, Herceptin, a PD-1 checkpoint inhibitor, and chemotherapy, and all together they work even better than any of those combinations by themselves. So that's led to this trial that we've opened a few months ago called Aviator, which is testing this very idea, in which patients who've already had the usual drugs like T-DM1 and pertuzumab and are randomized to either chemotherapy and trastuzumab by itself, or chemotherapy, trastuzumab, and one of these checkpoint inhibitors, or the whole enchilada, all four drugs together. And if you go on this trial and you get randomized to the one arm that doesn't have immunotherapy, if that doesn't work for you, you can then get all three of the antibodies after that. So everybody on this trial has access to at least one, if not two, immune therapy. So we think this is kind of a neat idea as a way to further build upon what looks like some activity of immune therapy in HER2-positive cancers, but still a ways to go. We think this is a promising way to do that. So we'll stop here for questions. Again, there's a lot of really interesting things being done in clinical trials right now. Most of the drugs we're looking at already have evidence that they work, and we're now just trying to build upon that. You already heard from Heather that one way we can do even better is by getting metastatic biopsies and blood biopsies to try to figure out how these cancers are becoming resistant, so we can come up with even more ways to try to reverse that. And the only way we're getting anywhere is by people participating in trials. So I will stop there, and I'm happy to have questions. Again, if you could write them down on the cards and give them to any of our research folks, we can go over them. I'll have to put my glasses on, or depend on Heather to read. And there's no question that's too simple. Probably questions that are too complicated.
So one question is, and I think we can broaden this a little bit, but if you've already stopped a medicine, in this case it was T-DM1 because of side effects, are you eligible for one of the clinical trials, like the clinical trial for the DS-8201? And that's a very good question, any other clinical trials. And so each clinical trial has a specific eligibility that if you are interested in and your doctor thinks that you would be a good candidate for, what will happen is you usually will meet with the research nurse together with the doctor will go through the specific eligibility for that specific trial and your specific situation and decide whether you would be right for that study and that the study would be right for you. Many patients have toxicities and side effects from other drugs previous to the one that there are, you know, prior to a trial, and so we can't give you something that will make that worse usually, but but it doesn't mean that you can't have any other trial. So it's each individual situation. I think that's
and just as a broader point, so sometimes it can be very frustrating about eligibility criteria because you may, you know, be very interested in a clinical trial and you find out that protocol says that you're not eligible because of X, Y, or Z. And I completely understand people's frustration with that. We're not trying to be sticklers, and we will do whatever we can to try to figure out a way around that. But the reason that the protocols are written with these specific criteria are to make sure that people who go on the trial, it's safe to put a patient on a trial, and that we can get the result, the information out of the trial that we can then interpret, because if there's a very big mixture of different kinds of patients on a trial, it's harder for us to understand what the results are. So it's a trade-off. There's also two kinds of trials. There's the trials that companies do that we participate in, and then there's trials that we write ourselves, like the neratinib trial that you heard of, that I mentioned from Heather. And the ones we write ourselves, we tend to write a little looser. And the one the companies write sometimes are a little bit more stringent. So if there's a trial that you might not be eligible for from a company, oftentimes there'll be what we call an investigator-initiated trial that may be that you may be eligible for. But again, we do our best to try to work around those kinds of barriers, but we completely understand the frustration, and there is a reason for it, but it can be frustrating.
Thank you.
Another question is, and a good one is, since immunotherapy is not, it only works for some with HER2-positive breast cancer, are there genomic research being pursued? And not just genomic research, but other types of laboratory and translational research to understand why that might be the case, and then also to develop ways to harness the immune system to better treat HER2-positive breast cancer and other kinds of breast cancer too. And there are a number of basic scientists here and elsewhere who are working on that very problem.
So one of the questions that was just brought up was about what are the most promising trials for brain metastases, which a very good question. We didn't. Oh, sorry, I forgot we're recording this. I just usually think I'm loud enough. So as Heather mentioned, brain metastases are relatively common with this specific kind of breast cancer, and that radiation usually works really well, but sometimes the cancer continues to grow or grows later after that. There are drugs that get into the brain pretty well and that can be helpful, but there's plenty of room for us to do better with that. And so the two main tacks that people are taking in terms of clinical trials for brain metastases are, one is trying to develop more of these small molecules like tucatinib, neratinib also gets into the brain. There's a whole new class of drug that the estrogen receptor positive cancer group is talking about, if you're in that working group, called a CDK4/6 inhibitor, and those actually probably also work in HER2-positive cancers, and so we're having a trial of one of these CDK4/6 inhibitors in HER2-positive disease that also looks promising. So new small molecules that cross this thing called the blood-brain barrier is one approach. The other approach is flipping that dogma on its head, which is that it turns out that blood-brain barrier may not be such a barrier when you have brain metastases, because when there's a tumor there, it seems to disrupt the blood-brain barrier to some extent, and so the barrier becomes leaky. And it turns out that big molecules like T-DM1 and Herceptin can get into the brain when there's a tumor there. There's a trial that's on right now that's looking at very high doses of Herceptin along with Perjeta, pertuzumab, and immunotherapy in people who have HER2-positive brain metastases. The idea is we know that some Herceptin trastuzumab can get into the brain. If we raise the dose in the blood, we should be able to get more into the brain. And so that's a trial that I think is a very good trial and is open right now. And it's kind of a nice approach. And there already are some data that high doses of trastuzumab plus pertuzumab can be effective in some people. So hopefully by adding the immune therapy, it's going to work even better. And it turns out that because trastuzumab is so exquisitely targeted to HER2, if you go up on the dose, it doesn't add more side effects. It just means you have to come into the clinic more. So those are the two approaches, new antibodies and new small molecules.
There's a question about, and I think this is a good one, an interesting one. Is the bill that Congress recently passed helpful for us? I'm blanking on the name of the bill, but there was Congress just passed a bill saying that patients had the right to try, is that it? The right to try any medication, even in a clinical trial, if they have already exhausted other approved lines of therapy for their treatment. And it's not just for cancer, it's for all issues, all medical issues. And there's something called a single agent IND, if you were in a situation with your cancer and with where your doctor and you were having a conversation and there was some particular medication that was the right one for you, that you determined was the right one for you, that you were not eligible for a clinical trial, that you could go through the process of getting approval for that medication. And we have, so there is already a mechanism that we think that also tracks that patient while they're getting that medicine, because our perspective here has been that there are enough clinical trials, that there are enough drugs available, that there are that are in study, and that it's much better for somebody to be part of a study to be so that we're understanding what's happening with their disease rather than having somebody on one medication that we might not be able to best track their symptoms, their benefit from the drug, or their lack of benefit from the drug. And that, so we I think it's not a, it's maybe helpful in other ways, but in general, I don't think it was a, there wasn't a big need in oncology for that because of this other mechanism. And in addition, we have so many active clinical trials all over that that we have not been using that mechanism. But it's an, it was an interesting bill, certainly. And is, someone asked if I'm recruiting for my neratinib study. Yes, very, I am. So if you're interested or and you think that you might be appropriate for it, you can talk to me or talk to your doctor, and we can talk more about that. And our liquid biopsies close to practical use. They are being, it's a great question, they are being used in lung cancer is the probably the most clear example where they're being used now in treatment. They are available commercially for use now in any cancer, but we have been using them from a research perspective primarily. I think that we're very close, and if you're interested, I'll talk about it later today, the different ways in which we're using them and hope that they'll be in the clinic quite soon. So those were the questions. I don't know.
Yeah. We have a minute or a few more minutes. If anybody, those, okay. I was going to say, if your handwriting was, you were embarrassed about your handwriting because it was like mine, you just wanted to talk, that would be okay.
Can you speak to metastatic breast cancer changing over time for HER2 positive to negative?
Yeah, so the question was, does HER2 positive breast cancer ever change from positive to negative? Or I guess the other question, does it ever change from negative to positive? And so it does. It doesn't do it very much. I'll clarify. So if you look at patients who have primary breast, an initial breast cancer, and they get their surgery and radiation and stuff, and then unfortunately their cancer recurs, if you compare that original cancer to the recurrence, about 8% or so change their HER2 status. So 90%+, it doesn't change. About 8% it changes, and it's more going from negative to positive than the other way around. And that kind of makes sense because, you know, cancers like their hair too. It makes them, you know, more invigorated. So they don't like to lose it because it kind of helps them grow. So most of the time they gain it. That's just looking at primary cancers going to metastatic. Once somebody has metastatic disease and they go through T-DM1 and Perjeta and you know, these other things, probably one way that they can become resistant is by losing their HER2, since, you know, we're using that as their Achilles heel. Sometimes it behooves them to lose the HER2 so that we can't keep targeting it. That probably happens. We don't really know how often it happens. People, you know, the kind of studies that Heather was mentioning that are looking at doing biopsies and ctDNA assays in people who've been through multiple lines of HER2 therapy, you know, we're trying to study that to see how often that happens. Because obviously, if they lose HER2, then we can't be using all of our HER2-directed therapies, and we need to come up with other approaches for those cancers. Right now, we just don't think that happens very often, but maybe after 4, 5, 6 types of HER2 therapy, it starts to happen more. We just don't have the data yet. And again, that's why we're trying to do these kinds of biopsies and other tests to figure that out, because obviously that would change our approach. So very good question, and we're trying to figure that out. How often it gets lost,
yeah,
after multiple lines. You know, I mean, my sense is it's somewhere in the 10 to 20% range. But interestingly, that's what I would have answered you last year. But I showed you that the only thing I have to speak against that, the reason why I'm reconsidering, is I showed you that waterfall plot for that drug called DS8201A, which, you know, 90% of the patients had shrinkage. So that's a very HER2-targeted drug, and those were patients who had had lots of therapy before, and yet that drug seems to work in most people. So that would suggest that at least the vast majority of cancers still have at least some HER2 on them. That drug is so powerful that even if you have a small amount of HER2, it looks like it still can be works, at least to some extent. So that's maybe a special case. But it probably happens, you know, the bottom line is HER2 loss probably happens sometimes. It probably is not very often, and it probably is not completely.